This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, so yesterday what we did, so we understood multiple layers. Okay, what is an app overview? The front end layer is called an app overview. Data manager is a cognitive engine where we can load data through a data manager, and use data manager can be used if you load data through a first option. Okay, well, we're creating an app, it is asking, right? Only then you can use this data manager. If not, you cannot use this data manager. Okay, let me also go through that. Okay, then you have a data load editor, which is your scripting part. So you can navigate to through this also, but when you navigate to this, okay, it'll open on the same page. So when I click on a data, it'll open on the same tab. Now I would want to keep it multiple tabs open, means you have to navigate to the navigation button. Actually, it has navigated to our data manager. Now we see when we are on a data manager, it's asking this table is added using the data load script. Okay, so we have to synchronize if I have to use a data manager. So I shall not do that because it still won't work. It says that it will work, but it won't work again. It will throw an error because it will try to create an auto generated script again. Okay. So let's not touch that up right now. So I'll close this part and we'll go to app overview. I'll keep it app overview open. So there are multiple navigations. If you should start from today onwards, only the practice, then only you'll get used to this. Hi Anushree, good morning. You're on mute, you're talking.
Okay. Hi Ravi, good morning. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible. Good morning.
Sorry for joining late.
No issue. I was just taking the last class what we discussed. Okay, I hope you've gone through my last class.
Yeah, I saw, but a few minutes I couldn't see.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Both of these, okay. If you have any doubts, I'll come back to that again. Okay, so today we'll try to create an application, okay, and learn few visualizations. That is our motive for today's class. Okay, in terms of how the class would proceed is because everyone is new here, so I'll maintain a content file. Okay, so each topic will be going sequence wise, and whenever a topic is finished, I'll mark it as done. Okay, so right now I didn't complete anything, okay. Everything is blank. Okay, and whenever you have any doubts, you can stop me then and there. Okay, ask me the doubts. If something you have to cover in the next topic, I'll say that it will be covered in the next topic. But if it's something related to the same topic, you can ask me then and then. Okay, you can bring out your project issues if you're rightly working on your project and you have some issues on your project also in terms of ClickSense, because everyone wants to learn on the real time, right? So how many examples I can get real time, because everyone will be facing a real time issues. So bring out your real time issues, real time problems. So everyone will be trying to learn that. That's where we can and learn. And all our sessions should be interactive sessions. I don't want everyone to be mute. Okay, if there is no background noise, you can unmute yourself, ask your questions. Okay, if there is noise, go back to mute again. Ask a question and you can go back. If there is two, because why I say go back to mute is because we are recording these sessions. And one when you're hearing back the same session, you'll feel irritated. I don't want that to happen. Okay, because a lot of background noise will get also recorded.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, clear? The ground rules. Okay, and whatever sessions I covered, go back and practice. Give at least an hour's time for you to go back and practice after the sessions. Okay, so that whatever I teach, apart from whatever I teach, I also will send you some assignments to practice. Okay, you have to practice my session, whatever I'm teaching in the session, plus on top of it, few of the assignments also. I'll send few POC assignments. Okay, so these are POC works, are real-time POCs, which are given in interviews or which are given, which are like POCs you do in office, right? So those POCs.
Okay.
Okay, I'll be sending some such sort of assignments also. Okay, so the more you ask, the more you learn. The more you make mistakes, the more you learn. Simple. Okay. Okay, so yesterday what we did, so we created a connection. Okay, so I'll do it once again for Anushriya, someone who has not understood. So we here, this is a scripting layer. Okay, it is a script layer, and these are your set variables. Okay, so we create a new connection. In this connection, this is where we'll connect to database connections and we'll connect to flat files connection, so folder connection. When I say flat files, all files is nothing but a folder connection. Okay, where your data is residing at your local desktop. Okay, all files, say where is your data files are. Let's suppose I say my data files are in somewhere in a certain folder. I suppose this is my data folder. Okay, so give the folder path. Okay, give the database or file name. Okay, I think this is same. I just give this as a data. Or, okay, create. So your connection gets created. From this connection, say select data and pick your data file. Okay, whatever file you would want to pick, go ahead and pick it. Let's suppose I say I would want to pick this file, select my file. While loading this file, we learn this, that this is your file name, okay, table name. So let me open this file. So this is my file which we have loaded. Okay, so if you see, this is my worksheet name. So worksheet name would be your, like a table name, it will show you. And 30 is the number of columns you have in your Excel sheet. Okay, 30 is the number of columns you have in your Excel sheet. Okay, and starting from your address column, see, first column is the address, so it'll come in the same sequence. If you don't want any of the column to be loaded, you can just simply uncheck it. If you also want to alias it, okay, you can also alias your name here itself. You just double click it. This was contact name. I would not want to make it as customer name. I want to make it as customer name. Yes. What does it try to do? It try to write as alias name. It does not change the source file name. It will just change the, give an alias name itself. Okay. Let me insert the script for you. Okay. You have to also be very careful. Where did you place your cursor while inserting it? Okay. I think I basically placed it somewhere in between my previous table and this table. So it is coming as wrong. So let me delete once again completely and we'll load once again. So we'll do this change. So this is customer name. Okay, insert the script. So we'll get a column name alias as customer name. Okay, now we'll define a table name to this. So this is like your select statement. Okay, you can just read like select columns or like select star or select all the columns from your table.
Suppose we have to change the data type of a column. Where do we change?
Yeah, you don't have a data type to be changed. So everything, data types and everything, ClickSense will take care of it. So you don't need to worry about that, whether you want to change the data type or not. So what does ClickSense try to do is, if it is a numerical column, it will store in a numerical column format. If it's a text format, it'll store in a text format. And if it is a date, okay, let's suppose if it is a date, okay, and let's it'll store in both dual format. It is like string and a text. Okay, and as a text, text will help you to represent on the front end. Numerics will be on a back end. It's called a dual format. We'll discuss. So dual is a function here. It will store in a dual format, dual of text as well as number format. Okay, your column would be stored in the two formats. Text will for your representation, number for your sorting purpose. That's what I say. I would want, see, in this case, what I say, let's suppose month is there. Month is what format? Let's suppose I say it's not number, it is like Jan, Feb, March, something, right? This is what text format. I would want to represent in the front end as like text format. But if I sort in the text format, what will come? Which month will come first? I think maybe April will come first because A is first, right? But this should not be our case. So what should be my text format? It should be sorted in the number format, like one. This is my second month. This is my third month. Okay, so we'll see this part in the next sessions. So I don't need to do any data type changes. It will take care of, it will handle the data types automatically. Okay, no data type change required. So whatever database, okay, whether you're loading from SAP HANA or Excel or any databases, okay, it'll always try to convert into its own data types. Okay, so it has only the same generic data types only, the numeric text part only, and a date format. So you don't need to do any data type change. Okay, so once you load it, let's load the data. So I just wrote like a select statement. They're executing the data. Okay, so 2,175 lines of records were loaded. And it is creating a binary search index for each of the field. So I'll show you where this binary search index gets created also. How does it create? You won't see the format of it, but we can see it in the log file. I'll show you. Close this. Now let's go back to your app overview. I think it is where I kept it open. Yeah. So this is your first section is your app overview. So whichever sections you are there, it'll get grayed out. Now we are in an app overview. Let's also go to a data model viewer. So this is your data model viewer. Data model viewer. Here you can see the structure of the table and some preview of the data. When I click on a table, so when I click outside, you won't get to see a preview. When I click on a table, you get to see a preview of the data. Okay, some 70 to 100 records we'll get to see here, not all the records, remember. Okay, so every column has its own data type. We need not change anywhere here. And you see how many records we are loaded, how many fields we are loaded. And if you see here, each field, when I click on address field, it will show you what data type is it. It's a text data. Tag means, actual tag is something like hashtags. Okay, it is hashtag to text. Category ID. Category ID is numeric and integer. Category name is text again. Let's suppose cost of sales, which is again a numerical field. Okay, fax field is again a numerical field, or it is not taken because it's a decimal, or a fax is neither it's an integer nor it's a numerical field. It's not showing us anything. Okay, fright again, it's a numeric. Month, this is again a text actually. ASCII text. Okay, order date. So date is stored in these numeric formats. Numeric, integer, timestamp, and a date. Because we have a timestamp also here, and the date also. That's the reason it is also showing you a timestamp. Okay, so every column it stores the format. You don't need to do anything. Okay, now let's come back to front end. So this is your sheet. So you can create multiple sheets. as you wish, any number of sheets. I always, while creating a sheet, give a proper name to a sheet and description. Now go to edit. So your sheet is empty at this point, no visualizations. Let's go to edit. Yeah. You have the list of fields, will display all the fields. If you have multiple tables, you can sort by table wise, or you can sort all the columns table wise. We'll see when we go to multiple tables. Now master items, we'll come back to master items. Now let's go back to charts. These are the different chart types where which we can create in a QlikSense visualization. Okay. Here is your, this is your empty sheet. And you, on the right hand side, you see the sheet properties. You have some like summary, okay? You can define your sum, let's suppose I say this summary analysis. Okay, you can give a heading to this title or a title to this sheet so that an end user can know what he can look into this sheet. Okay, you can give some title expression, or you can still give some description about this. Okay, and wherever you see this FX means, you can write some formula into it. Let's suppose I just want to write my today's date. When did I create? So I said today is a function. Okay. And I'll just use today. Okay. So I'll get to know when is this created. So 4 to 2019 is what you created this. Okay. So wherever it is in FX, you can write your formula there. Thumbnails. Thumbnails is, let's suppose, is something, let's suppose you are seeing a sheet like empty here, right? Now I would want to represent this on some image. Maybe a company logo, or maybe some scenic, or maybe a graph. Okay, you can use a thumbnail. So let me take some thumbnails. But how do I get these thumbnails? You have to place an image into your documents. So once you install QlikSense, everyone has to find out this folder, documents, click, sense. This is your project folder. Okay. All your apps or applications will come down to into this folder. So right now we are working on a application called demo application. Okay. So demo.qv has got created. So this is application which store all your information, your data. Okay, your visualizations, everything will be stored in these applications. This will be there here. Now, I would want that images, right? The images has to be placed into this content folder. Content default. So these are a few images we need to place here. I have a few, like some TRX, NRX, something. Okay, we have to place into this folder. So then only you can use it. See, right now it immediately takes to that folder only. Let's say I would want to use some image. Maybe an orange, just an orange. Yeah, I think it's orange. So I want to use the green color. Insert. So as soon as I insert a thumbnail, it should be seen over here. This is our thumbnail. Okay. So here you can place your company logo or any picture. Okay. Or once you created your visualizations, okay, you can just take a screenshot and also use that as also has a thumbnail. People also do that. Okay, then you can also adjust these grid lines. What are these grid lines? As QlikSense is a responsive, okay, auto responsive sheet. It auto adjusts its dashboard based on your screen size, means based on your hardware. Let's suppose you created your dashboard on your laptop, but when your user want to access it through his mobile, yes, he can do that. It auto adjusts his screen size. You don't need to worry about that. If you want to access through a tab, you can also access it. Auto adjust the screen size. Okay, so this is a pixel resolution pixel based dashboard. QlikSense is a pixel based dashboard. According to the pixel sizes of your hardware, okay, it auto adjust the screen size. So you see here, you see the sheet size is responsive. Okay, you can make it custom also. Okay. Custom width and custom height, but not unless until you have a specific requirement, we don't make this custom. It's beta responsive only. But this grid lines in a responsive also, you can make it medium, and narrow. What is the use of this? I'll come back. Let me repeat it wide at this point of time. And let's suppose you all use a smartphone space. How do you like to scroll? Top to bottom or left to right?
Top to bottom.
Top to bottom, right. Now let's suppose I would want to build a dashboard where I would want to scroll top to bottom. So see, this space, let's suppose this is a limited space only I have. How many visualizations I can fit? Maybe 5 to 6 visualizations I can fit here. I didn't get, Pavani, you were asking something?
Yeah, in the title expression where you mentioned the function today, if I wanted to see the date and the time, is there something other function where I can also see the time?
Yes, I'll show that. So we have a function called now. There's also a function called now. Now is a function which will give you date and time. Now is a function which will give you date and time. Okay, we'll come back about the functions. There are a lot of functions. So if I would want to make it my dashboard, just to not to create multiple sheets, I just want only one sheet, but all the visitors to fit in one sheet, so I can extend my sheet. Here we have an option of extending a sheet. So your sheet can be extended, you see. Now your sheet is so big. Okay, so all your visitors can fit into one single sheet. Let me hold this right for time being. It won't go back immediately. Now let's create a chart. Now I would want to compare my sales with my category. So here, if I see, this is a retail store information. Okay. So I have sales. I have sales called cost of sales. I have sales quantity. Okay. Year wise. This is my quantity. This is my sales. And a few categories. Now I would want to compare how much each category has made a sales. Okay, so for that, whenever I would want to compare something, I would use a bar chart. Okay, you should also understand when should I use what chart. Okay, creating visualization is easy, but app chart at the app time. Okay, now I say that I would want to compare. For any comparison, we would use a bar chart. Let's say category name is what I would want to compare and add a measure. Simple, just go to your measure column, sales, and you have these measures. Okay, sum of sales, count of sales. We don't do a count of sales, it should be count of order, right? But it will show you all the measure. You can use average sales, min sales, and max sales. Right now, I just want to show these are your aggregations, default aggregations. I'll just use sum of sales. Okay. You can always adjust your chart and drag and drop. So your chart always will be adjusted on the grid lines. Okay, so it will only be adjusted on the grid lines. See, the smallest you can make is the grid line. The largest, you can make it full sheet. Okay, and you can only adjust on the top of the grid lines. Okay, always give a proper heading to your chart. So this is your sales by category. Okay, let's give, okay, let's understand the properties of your charts right now. So when I click on a blank area, I'll get sheet properties. When I click on a chart, I'll get my chart properties. Okay, starting from your, this is the first column. This is a column named category name. Now I say that it will display as a category name. I say I would want to give a separate label. Maybe I just say I would want to just give a category only as my label. You can label it. It will just show you category. Okay. Include null values. We don't have any null values in your dimension at this point of time. So I'll come back to this once again. Limitations, I'll come back. Okay. Then come back to measures. So measures, what it's saying, sum of sales. It's actually showing your formula or an expression. This we call it as expression. And I don't want to show an expression. I guess I would want to see it as my total sales. So we can change that. You can also label that total sales. Okay, so this is total sales label. Now, what should be number formatting? Before that, before going to the number formatting, we'll go to appearance. And in the appearance, we have general, which is nothing but sales title to this. If you want, you can give some subtitle also. Subtitle is, you can say, a specific, or you can say this is, this consists of, let's say, data points to all years, something, okay? Some title you can give. And if you want to leave a note, that some assumptions, you have taken some assumptions, we'll calculate in this. Okay, you can give a note to an end user. This is called footnote. Okay, it'll come at the bottom. You have seen many visualizations, right? So how is this, or what is the source of this information? Footnote, let's suppose this is my source. Okay, as a source is my Excel. What is the source from where we have got this data? Okay, our registration will come back. Presentation. So now you can use a bar chart, vertical format or horizontal format. Okay, and you also would see what is scroll alignment. So you get to see a scroll on your left hand side, right? On your right hand side, this is a scroll actually. You cannot use it here, you have to come back out of it. Okay, when it's a bigger chart, I'll come back to this again. Then colors and ledger. Now value labels is what I want. I would want to see the value labels on top of my bars. Okay, I'll come back to again my number formatting. So by default, it converts, if a value is in million formats, it converts into million automatically. If you would want to, if a value is at 1,000 level, it'll convert to 1,000. So this KM by default, it'll convert. So you don't need to change those things. So ClickSense will handle those things. No, you say I would want to show specifically, but this is in an auto format. Automatically this. No, I would want in a specific format, a number. It'll show a full number. Okay, in a number, you can again say, I would want one decimal, or I don't want any decimal. You can adjust that. Okay. A number, if it is in a decimal percentage, you can also show in percentages. Now I would want to show money format. Yes, I can go ahead and show in a money format. So dollar and with two decimals. Let's say I would want only one decimal, it has to delete a zero here. It will become one decimal. Okay, so date duration won't work here. You can also give a custom format. As well as I say, I would want to show you. My own format, so go to a custom. Okay, what should be a decimal separator, what should be a thousand separator, what format you would want. Okay, you can specify this here. You see a million or a K symbol, you can create it by yourself. Okay, but you have to divide that value. So the division has to happen inside your scroll. Suppose I say I would want to divide it this by 1,000. So divide by 1,000. So we are divided by 1,000. Now I would want to show a symbol here. So this is my 1,000K. So this is 679.70K. I don't want two decimal, or I don't want a decimal. I can just remove this. I'll just say 680K. This is a formatting of your number formatting. Okay, you can go to custom. So before that, we divided it here. Then we change the format pattern. Okay, sorting. Now I say I would want to sort my categories based on my sales value. So I say women's wear is selling highest. I would want it to be my first bar. Okay, so this is sorting. Sorting will always show you your measure wise sorting or your dimension wise sorting. So here I would want to say that I would want to sort my dimensions based on my sales value. Okay, go to category. By default it is auto, so disable the auto. So I don't want to sort it alphabetically. You can sort it alphabetically. So see B. So this is like alphabetical B, C, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S. Okay. Sorting by numerically won't work here. Okay, because it shows in a different format. So where I disable it, it is actually showing in some format because some other numerical won't work here. What I would want it is, I would want to sort this by sales value. So I'll go to sort by expression. What was my expression we wrote there? Sum of sales. The same expression we'll write here. Sum of my sales. Okay, you can go to this FX, you can expand this. Sum of my sales. Always see that your expression is evaluated okay. You should always say okay. And your column names are case sensitive. If I write a small s also, error in expression. And you see, the column name will show you in black color. Means it is actually not available. The column name is always in an orange color. Your function is always in a blue color. Your function name is not case sensitive. Function you write sum or anywhere you can write. Whatever way you write, it is not case sensitive. But your column names are case sensitive. Okay, apply this. Okay, now this is an ascending order. I would want to make it descending order. Now I get sales by dimension values. So these are my dimension values. Okay, sorted accordingly. Okay, now I'm talking like dimensions and measures. So does everyone understand what is a dimension and what is a measure? I think I say everyone is from a BI background. Ram?
Ravi,
you have understood, right? Anushri?
No, Ravi, I'm from pharma background.
Okay, so that's what I got that doubt. Let me explain you first what is a dimension and what is a measure. Okay, I'll write a statement. So you only tell what you understand this. Okay. I'll say that Ravi has purchased laptop worth 50K from Bangalore in the year 2018. Okay, so this is a statement or this is a transaction. You can think that this is like a transaction happened, right? In this, yeah. Let's find out your measure column and dimensions. So what do we have in this? Okay, first, let's say what is my measure? Measure is something fact, right? Actual. What is actual here? 50,000.
Yeah.
Right, this is my, we can call it as amount. This is my amount column. Or now in our case, example, because this is my sales value.
Okay.
Okay, what are my dimensions? How do I identify which customer has bought what?
By the name.
So there's one name column, a name column. Okay, laptop is your product. This is also a dimension. And when we have bought, year is also a dimension.
Okay.
And we also have a city. City also has dimension. So these many things are your dimension. Means if you have to identify, let's suppose I suggest say sales of 1 lakh. you don't get any meaning of this, right? Right. You don't have any meaning to this. Sales of 1 lakh, but when, where, whom, what? You don't know any meaning of this. When you made a sales, what you say, what sales you have made, unless and until it is grouped or it is attached to a particular thing, maybe to a customer name, right? Maybe to a year or a city or a product. So you are actually grouping it. So these are called your dimension columns. These are your dimensions. Okay, always your dimensions are your numerical or text columns. Basically, these are your texts which you group it. Okay, this is something like you're grouping this, you're attaching these things to your sales value. Okay, you made 1 lakh sales to so and so customers. Maybe customers' names can be A, comma B, multiple customer names. Okay, in the year 2018. Okay, city can be Pune or Bangalore or something. Right, a product can be here, any product, okay, XYZ products. Okay, it can be a detergent, it can be a soap, sorry, it can be laptops, it can be high-end servers. Not clear? Dimension and sales?
Yeah.
Okay. So to this, okay, we'll also understand how, where, in a real time, how are they stored in our tables. Okay, for now, this is enough to understand what is my measures and what is my dimensions. Okay, using, okay, now we also have to understand one more thing. So there are two things here to understand. One is a metric. Okay, one is a KPI. Okay, someone from a BA background, can someone tell me what is a metric and what is a KPI? Madhu, Pavani.
Metric means column names, right? So
no.
Yeah.
No.
A metric, what I can define is it's like a measurement.
Yes, it is like a measurement. Okay. Yes. What is then KPI? KPIs, okay, don't give me the definition. KPI is nothing but key performance indicator. Okay. But what is KPI? Okay, what is key performance indicator? Okay, now let me say the two things. Yeah,
it's basically demonstrating how your measurement has been done.
Yes. So you are basically comparing it. So KPI, let's suppose everyone is going through an annual appraisal, right? Okay, how is the appraisal is measured?
Based on performance.
Based on, first of all, based on your objectives.
Oh yeah.
Right. First, based on your objective, you set a goals at the beginning of the year, goal setting. Right? So at the beginning of the year, you set your goals. At the end of the year, they try to compare it. Okay, have you achieved all the goal settings? What you have given it for yourself. Okay? Based on that only, they try to see whether you have achieved your, whether you have met your performance indicators. This is what this KPI means. So you have met your, whether you have met your goals or not. Okay, so measurement is at a high level. Okay, you just say like measurement is like, you just say sales value. Okay, I'll just say 1 lakh. This is my measurement. Okay, or this is my metric. This is my metric. Okay, but when I say sales, okay, for the year 2019 versus 2018, means I'm actually comparing it. Okay, or I say that, okay, or you can also say that sales target, you have given a target. His target was maybe 1 million. Okay. Actuals is, okay, let's suppose actuals is 50,000. Actually is 50,000. Here, this is also a metric. You are measuring actuals with your targets. Okay, specific. Always KPI is specific to your goals. Okay, you're actually measuring, let's suppose it can be like sales persons versus his goals or his targets. This is always specific. This is also key. That's the reason we're saying key performance. How do we indicate a performance? You're doing good or bad. Okay, based on some target only we'll identify that's a good or bad. Now clear, a metric and a KPI. But how do we get a KPI and how do we get a metric? So metric is just simply a fact column, is like simply like a sales. But a KPI is with dimension, okay, and a measure column is your KPI. Okay, people do ask in interviews actually, how do you derive a KPI and all those stuff. Okay, so your KPI is has to be used a dimension and a measure to derive a KPI. Okay, without dimension, without measure, you cannot define a KPI, or you cannot, you won't get a KPI, you just get a metric value, just a sales value, that's it. Unless and until I group it by these dimensions, it can be customer name, it can be salesperson name, okay, anything, year, city, product, multiple dimensions. Clear all of this stuff? Now let's go back to our visualizations again. So we added, we did the sort part of it. Okay. So add-ons is again, let's suppose for a dimension value, I don't have a sales. Okay. I think I'll come back. Let me create one more bar chart. Add a dimension here. I'll add country because I have some countries which does not have a sales value. Okay. So this is your scroll bar, you see. This scroll bar automatically comes up actually. Okay. Based on the size of your chart. Now if you see, this as does not say here, we don't have a sales value. Here we don't. The dimension is empty here. There is a null actually. There is no dimension value here. Okay. So I say I don't want to see this in my chart. If I don't want to see this, I can simply in a country column, I can say disable null values. Okay. You see it is gone now. It is no more visible. That's how you can change that. Okay. Let's suppose for a country we don't have a sales value. Let me add a value labels on top of this. Let's see if all the countries have a sales value or not. Okay. Now again, I get one more null here. There's some sales value it is getting picked it up actually. Or this has gone back. Or it has gone back actually. Yeah, that's how you can suppress your null values. Okay, if it is a measure value, you suppose there is a dimension. Now suppose I keep this and the add-ons also I can suppress this. Let's say it still shows you. If there is some zero in there, I don't want to show a zero value. I have dimension. I dimension, let's suppose Sweden or some other country, let's suppose Norway is there. I don't have a sales for a Norway, it shows you zero. Okay, there is no sales. So in that case, I don't want, so include zero values, you can disable this part. Okay, clear? That is what your add-ons. Come back to appearance once again. So we saw vertical, horizontal, then your grid lines. So these are your grid lines inside. So if you see, there are grid lines inside. These are your grid lines. You say you don't want these grid lines, or you would want a narrow grid lines. You can adjust these grid lines. So grid lines medium, or you say I don't want no grid lines. The grid lines will get disappeared. So there is no grid lines here. Yeah. So this all depends upon your how would you represent your visualizations. Okay. Not necessarily that you keep always grid lines or you remove grid lines. Okay. Now interesting is your colors. So everyone likes colors. So by default, auto color would be blue color. Disable that. Single color, if you would want all the bars to be shown one color, you can change to different colors. Let's suppose I say I would want to change it to green, and to change it to blue, orange, yellow. Okay, whatever colors, I can define my colors. Individual colors, this is all bars would be showing single color. Now I would want to show each dimension value one color. So I can say by dimension. Okay, so each value of a dimension would be given one color. Okay, here we have two color schemes, 12 color scheme or 100 color scheme. A slight change. Now, I would want, let's suppose women's wear, because there is women's wear, I would want to be it to be pink. And because it's sports wear, maybe sports, what do you use? Maybe let's suppose I would want it to be aggressive, I would want it to be red color. I would want to define my own colors to each of the dimension. In this case, we go and use a master dimension. Okay, when I come back to master dimensions, I'll cover this, where I can define each value of a dimension one color. Default color, you can define whatever color you would want. But here, you cannot define a specific color. Okay, so it can be 12 color scheme or 100 color scheme. This is the only thing. Now, I don't want by dimension. I want by sales value, by measure. So what does it does is it tries to create a min value and a maximum value. Based on that, it tries to identify. So maximum value is a darker color. So lesser than that, so it will keep on reducing the colors, min to max. Min to max. Okay. In the next sequence of classes, it actually tries to create groups. Okay. 49 to less than 259K is one color pattern. 259 to 469, one color pattern. 469 to 679, one color pattern. Okay. Here we have a divergent gradient or a divergent classes. You can also reverse this. In this part also, so now highest sales is giving a darker color. Now you would want to reverse this, you can also do reverse that. This part also, if you want to reverse, you can reverse it. Okay. Here, now again, you say that each segment, I would want to define my own color. I don't want, so these are the default four colors of the four patterns by measure. Now I would want to define my own pattern or own colors. Again, you have to use it through master items. Master items, measure value. So we'll again come back and see that. Then we have, where do you want this legend position? This legend position on the right hand side, but now it is on the right hand side. You would want it to be on the bottom. Okay. We would want it to be on the left side or on the top. You cannot change the chart label colors.
Okay.
Chart heading colors, chart label colors, your chart text colors, you cannot change it. If you have to change it, all the colors will get changed. Let's suppose I go back to my sheet. Here you have gray color, okay, font color. Suppose I make it my font. Okay, I think this font is only changing to the heading part only, but you cannot change this fonts here. Font color is not possible to change. Okay, so if you go to these three dots, this is where you can come back to your settings. But these settings are only for a sheet settings. Okay, font colors you cannot change, but you can change the theme of your charts. Let's suppose, let me change. So right now we're in a classic. I'll want to change into breeze. A color scheme will change. Now you see, you'll get a much smoother colors. Let me come back. There's a much smoother colors you get. But a font color, so n clicksense you need to remember is you don't have font size settings. You don't, you cannot change the font format also. Let's suppose I would want Arial, okay, Vardana or something. You cannot change that. There's no font settings. You cannot change the font colors. Okay, all are standardized. Okay, see, you know, these all colors got changed. Looks good. Okay, because we changed the theme actually. Okay, now we have X category, X axis. This is your X axis. Okay, so whether you would want to show your labels and your title. Okay, or I just say I would want to only show labels because everyone knows that these are my category names. You can just say I would want to show only labels. Now I would say I would want to see only title, but which is not recommended because I don't know what each category is. Okay, so I don't want anything, I can say none. Okay, but I would want to show just now I would want to show only labels. Let's say. Okay, and where this label you would want to place it. Okay, by default, these are because it's too lengthy, it automatically changes into horizontal. This is horizontal or tilted, only two options. Okay. And where this position should be, bottom or on the top, it convert to the top. Okay. Again, bottom looks good, or we are used to that. Okay, on the Y axis, this is your Y axis. So this is your X axis, this is your Y axis. Okay, basically for Anushree, I'm writing because she's not from a yeah, background. So this is Y axis, this is X axis. Now on X axis, again, you can change this pattern. Okay, whether I would want labels and titles, or just say I would want only labels. Because anyway, you are saying sales by category, so you don't need to specifically mention again this is total sales. Again, this left or a right, so left or a right, whatever you want to choose, and a scale. So a scale is right now is medium 0, 500K, 1000K. Now I would want to show a narrow scale like 0, 200K, 400K, 600K, 800K. Okay, or a wide scale. So it'll when I say wide, 0 to 1000. That's it. Always you can make it medium or a narrow. Let's keep it narrow. Okay. And you have a range setting. So what is your maximum value? Your maximum value is 6979.7K. Plus the reason actually is showing you 800K. Okay. So disable. So where it should start? Your min should start from zero. No, I say that my min should start from 50K because my lowest value is 50. I'll say 50. You see, it starts from 50K actually. The X axis starts from 50K. Okay. Now, I say I would want to set my maximum value. My maximum value is what? Okay, right now is 679. I said 700 should be my maximum. So 700 is my maximum because 679 or 680 is my maximum. So I say 700 is my maximum. Okay. Or you would want to see a good different pattern of it. I'll reduce my min and max value. Okay, let's suppose I'll say my maximum is min and max should be both equal 50. My maximum also should be 50 only. Okay, or 0 and 0 and 50. And both min and max cannot be same. There is also one way of representing, we call it as 100%. So something like it is a break. Okay. Any visualization, anywhere, any tool, if you say that there is a break in the bar means, okay, means actually this is not representing the height. Okay, this is not representing the height of your values. It is just showing this bars, but you can see the values here. This is 680K, this is 692K. Okay. This is one way of representing. People also like this way of representation. Your bar does not represent the height of your values. Okay, so 50k, because it's a maximum value is 50k, doesn't it? There's no bar on top of it. This is also one way you can represent your data. Okay, let me make it min and max to be 600 and 0 and 700. Come back again. Clear? Any doubts in these properties? So these are all the properties for a chart. Almost same properties here and there for each and every chart. We'll see those things. Now let me create one more chart. So we'll understand one by one. So we'll understand the easiest one first. So we'll go back to line chart. Now when do I use a line chart? When do you think we should use a line chart? Yeah, Bhavani, I'll come back to the stack bar chart. Let me finish this, I'll come back to stack bar chart. When should I use a line chart?
Maybe when we have a continuous set of information, like to show the flow.
Yes, whenever you would want to see a trend in the data. Okay, when I mean to say a trend, okay, how is your data moving from 1 year to other year? So how is your sales when compared from last year to this year or 17, 18, 19? Okay, your time dimension, your line chart is always time dimensions. What are my time dimensions? Add a dimension. What are my time dimensions? Year is my time dimension, right? Year, month, quarter. Okay, so these are all my time dimension, time related. Okay, so we'll use year in this case as a dimension and add a measure. Simple. You can again use a sales. So it will give me a trend actually. Okay, from 2009 onwards till 2012, how is my sales is moving? Okay, I can say this is a sales trend. Okay, go ahead and do so. All the formatting pattern remains the same for everything, and in the line you have two formats, line and an area chart. So show data points. Once you show data points, so data points will come up, and then you can use the value labels. Okay, so if you're not enabled data points, you won't get to see the value labels option here. First, you have to show data points, then only value labels will be coming up. Okay, I'll off the grid line, because I don't want the grid lines. So there would be no grid lines. Colors, again, you can define whatever color you would want. It's a single color, or I said by measure color. Okay. There's one more option for by expression. I'll come back to this. That is conditional coloring. By expression, nothing but a conditional coloring. We'll discuss it once again. Okay. So rest all properties remain the same for each and every chart. Here you can also say whether you would want to say continuous scale. So if your data is continuous, like 10 point, what are continuous? So there are two types of data, right? Continuous and discrete. Continuous data and discrete data. Right. What is continuous? Something like sales value. Okay. Like 10, 10.5, okay, 16, 20.05. So this is your continuous data. What is discrete? Okay, discrete is like your ages. Okay. Or you can say yes or no. Okay, or you're like age cannot be in decimals, right? Age can be only in, I suppose, 35 is my age or 22 is my age. right? Or 45 is my age. Okay, this is not continuous, it is a discrete data. Okay, so this is a continuous data. So how do you want to show? Okay, so you would want to say continuous scale or discrete. So when I say continuous, it actually continues from last year to this year. The pattern changes, this is chart pattern changes. When I say discrete, this is a single figure, this is a single figure, this is a single figure, this is a single figure. Okay, there's no relationship from one to other. When I say continuous, it starts from 2009 till 2012. Okay, so mini chart is nothing but again a slide label at the bottom. Don't want, you can disable that. If something is not fitting, you can also use your logarithm scales. We'll come back to these log scales. Okay, all of these values will be converted into log scales, so we don't need this at this point of time. The logarithm scale is only applicable when all values are either positive or negative. We don't want logarithm scales right now. We'll discuss it later. Okay, now clear on the line chart. So whenever you want to see a trend, now comes the interesting which Pamani was asking, a stacked bar chart.
So Ravi, before you proceed on stack bar, I have a question on line chart.
Yeah, tell me.
Okay, for example, I have like a start year and the end year, and the product was available. I wanted to show the product was available only from so and so 2010 to 2011. The second product is available from 2012 to 2013. Can you show that in this line chart?
Product specific? No. I think we have to write through a set analysis. Okay, so directly, let's suppose, how do I identify which product is from where? Right now we are not gone to that level. I'll come back to that anyways. Right now, okay. We're saying that. Okay, so now let's suppose I add a product here. In a line chart, we'll add a product. Okay, which is my product name. What does it give me? It just gives me. So this is not a right way of representing a product, because these individual product names were not showing any trend.
Okay.
Right. We're not showing any trends. A line chart, whenever using a product name, you should never use a line chart, first of all, because they are not showing you here. This, it is showing you a trend. But what is this trend? There's no meaning to a trend. Whenever using a, like any categorical values, DIAM, category name, okay, or a product name or a customer name, always you have to use a bar chart only. Okay. Maybe I'll have to understand your question once again. Okay, we'll come back to that, because it's not straightforward. We have to write a set analysis for that. Okay, park your questions. We'll discuss it once again. Now, your stack bar chart. What is a stack bar chart? When I would want to show, let's suppose I say I would want to see sales by, let's suppose I say I would want to see sales. Okay, by country and by city, or by country and by category. Okay, this is my sales. So this, I would want to break it down, this bar, I would want to break it down. Let's suppose these are my countries. Okay, I would want to break it down by category again. So in this case, what are we using? We are using two dimensions, correct? We are using country as one dimension, and we are also using category as one dimension. We are also using category as a dimension. And a bar height is your nothing but your sales. Okay, let's do this. We already have a top. Let's make this as a stack bar chart. Okay, when can I make a stack bar chart? Do we have an option of it this point of time? You don't have an option. See, is it vertical or horizontal? That's it. We don't have an option. When this will get enabled, whenever you add more than one dimension or more than one measure. Okay, let me add a dimension first. In this, I'll add a category name as one more dimension. Okay. By default, it creates a grouped chart. Say, you're not getting to see the result, but it has created a group chart for Austria. These are different categories. So let's convert this into a stack bar chart. So go back to your appearance. By default, it is a group chart. When you add multiple dimensions, you have to create a stack chart. So earlier, we didn't get to see these two options. Now we get to see these two options. Let me make the chart a bit bigger. So it's clear. Okay, now I see that for each country wise, okay, these are different categories. When you put your mouse point on top of it, say in Germany, okay, how baby wear is sold, how bus class is sold, how children's wear is sold, and five more. Okay, here, one disadvantage here is we cannot display values for each segment. Okay, unless until you don't put your mouse point. This is a total value. Unless and until you don't display your mouse, okay, you don't get to see each categories. If you just display a category here, okay, how much each categories has sold, you get to know. Okay, but you cannot display values for each category. It will show you the total value. So in a Germany, we have made 519k sales, and how that is split up. Clear?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Now let me take one more object, a simple object, a KPI object. KPI object, as I said, here it will only take only one measure. There is no dimension to this. I'll add a measure, maybe a simple sales as my measure. It will show you a total value. That's it. I can say this is my total sales. These are your visualizations. Your sheet is finished up. Once this is done, now you want to always save this and say done. You come out of that. This is how your end user would be viewing the chart. End user would be viewing his dashboard. Any doubts so far, Anushri, Madhukar?
No, good.
Okay, so I'll send out the data file. Okay, so play around with for today. Okay, I would want you to create a stack bar chart, a bar chart, and a line chart. So all the visualizations, try creating those things. Okay, and do a formatting. Okay, it is left to your representations. Okay, your creative thinking. How what colors you would want to use. Okay, what label names you would want to, okay, unless until you start writing your label names and everything, okay, you won't be able to make it a practice of it. So first install your ClickSense. Everyone has installed or not? Okay, so figure that out. Madhukar, we'll discuss once again. Yeah. And figure this out. Okay, and player, I'll send the data file immediately after the session and the recording session also.
Okay.
Okay.
Recording session will be there in the same link, right? Yesterday you shared, right? So,
no. Every time a new link will come up, so I have to send the link once again.
Okay.
I'll send the link once again. I'll mail it. Anushri, any doubt?
Not now, Ravi. Once I'll practice, if I have anything, I'll ask.
But is the session clear for you?
Yeah. Right now, it's all fine.
Okay. Good. So practice it, then only you'll get to know, you'll get doubts. Okay, only you practice, you get doubts. Okay, so chalo, we'll meet tomorrow, same time. Okay, then.
Yeah.
Bye-bye. Yeah, thank you, take care, bye-bye.